third shloka, which is what is the most beautiful symbolic representation of life. There could not have been a better representation of life and the nuances of life and living other than this. And this all is thousands of years old. He says, Atmanam Rathinam Vidhi, Shariram Rathamevatu, Buddhim Tu Sarathim Vidhi, Manah Pragrahamevacha. A very beautiful analogy. Now that we know that we have to go from our physical, mental realization to where? God realization. So it's a journey. Where is the journey? Not going outside. Journey is going within ourselves. Now what is this journey is asking about? He says, if for this journey we need a vehicle to travel. Like anywhere we have to go, we need a car or some vehicle to travel. In those days, of course, there was no automobiles like which are today. What was the transport then? It was a chariot. So very beautifully our Yama is trying to explain to Nachiketa. So you have to understand Yama's amazing teaching skills. And you should understand the Nachiketa's age and size. To him he is teaching. To kind of a higher primary school kid, he is teaching about life and what is required, how to live his life, how to reach the ultimate goal. How beautiful he is teaching, you see. He is giving a very beautiful example. Like teachers of primary, higher primary have to give examples, objects of the daily things that children see and then explain to them that is how it is. But you explain as many times what is a dog, the child won't understand. If you show him a dog, immediately child understands. No explanation is needed. Similarly, you want to explain an abstract concept to a young boy or child, you have to bring some symbol, some example to them. And then they feel, yes, this is how I understand this. Long ago I heard a joke. It so happened that a person met his friend after 20-25 years. And then he started running to beat this friend. So his wife asked, after 25 years you have met, and why are you running behind and beating this fellow? He said, he had called me a hippopotamus in my school time. So in school time he called you a hippopotamus. Why are you running and beating him now? Because yesterday when we went to zoo, then only I found out what hippopotamus is. So now I know the meaning, and this is what he called me 25 years ago. Do I look so ugly and big and fat? So he's running behind to beat him. So unless you have known the, understood the example, if he had seen the hippopotamus, then he would have understood what his friend is calling him about. So he didn't understand, so he didn't beat him then. Likewise, children need some examples to prove to them how things are. Show them. And what is real, you can show them like an animal or a bird. But what is not there, what you can do? You have to give another simile or a allegory or a metaphor, and that is how you have to teach. So Yama is teaching Nachiketa. He is telling, think of this Atman within as the passenger of a chariot. In those days, there were only chariots driven by horses, horse carriages like. So he says, think of your Atman as the passenger. Then, of what? Of this Sharira. Sharira is the chariot. And who is the passenger? Atman is the passenger. And what happens? Buddhim tu sarathim. Who is the charioteer? Who is the driver of this chariot? Your buddhi, your intelligence, your intellect, vijnana. That is the charioteer. Vidhi. And manaha pragraham evacha. And your mind is the reins, and that is what is called pragraha. So this pragraham is that. So who are the horses and where are they going is the next question you should ask to complete the analogy. And he says, Indriyani hayan ahu vishayan steshu gocharan atmendriyam manoyuktam bhokte tyahur manishinaha. Now, if you divide again this, so first four things you got to know, body is the chariot, passenger is the Atman, charioteer is the buddhi, the intelligence, and mind, sankalpa, vikalpa, all thoughts and emotions together are the controlling reins. Now who are the horses? He says, Indriyani hayan ahu. Sense organs are called as indriyas. They are the horses of this chariot. And what are these roads on which these horses are running? Vishayan, the worldly sense pleasures or sense experiences. That are the road on which this chariot is running, these horses are running. And gocharan means that which is perceived. What is perceived? The road is perceived. By whom? By the horses. They are seeing the road and they are running on these roads. So senses are running behind sense objects. Eyes are running behind sights. Nose is running behind smells. Tongue is running behind taste and talk. Ears are running behind listening. So like this, each organ is pulling this chariot on towards the sense objects. Like horses are running towards its whatever the destination is. So like that, this is happening. This is the symbolism of the chariot. And who is actually enjoying the ride? He says Atma is enjoying the ride. How? Indriya Mano Yuktam. Having been endowed with Indriyas, the sense organs, and the mind, which experiences all these things through the sense organs, with them together, it is the Bhokta, it is the enjoyer of the ride, is what is being said. Who? The Atmanam, who is the passenger. So you are the Atman, who is the passenger, who is enjoying this chariot ride with the help of the Indriyas and the mind, which are able to collect all kinds of interactions of the world and then pass it on to you, and then you are enjoying this ride of life, is how it's been said. This is what the Manishinaha means, intelligent people say. Now let us dwell on this a little more deeper. Five horses are there. Each of them have their eyes, ears and nose and tongue and shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. Shabda is hearing sound, that is with the ears. Then sparsha, which is touch. Then rupa, sight. Rasa, taste. Gandha, the smell. So all these things are actually going about doing their own job, these five senses. And they run towards what? Something nice to see, let us run. Something ugly to see, let us run faster. Something nice to hear, let us hear. Something gossip, scandal, let us hear more attentively. Nice sattvic food, let us eat. Nice rajasic or tamasic food, let us run and eat more. This is how indriyas are. Like untamed horses. That's why some people say, I don't want to hear these things, but why do I end up hearing? I don't want to do these things, why do I end up doing? I don't want to speak such things, why do I end up speaking? Because these indriyas have a instinct of their own. That is why Arjuna, after listening to so much discourse, he asks, Atakenam prayuktoyam papam charati purushaha anichchannapi varshneya baladiva niyojitaha. He says, why do we behave in a wrong way? By what reason do we commit sins? Papam charati purushaha, that we commit sins. And it's anichchannapi varshneya, even though I don't want to commit, O Krishna, why do we end up committing sin? As if baladiva niyojita, as if we have been forced to commit sin. Despite us not wanting to do wrong, as if we are forced, hypnotized. As if under somebody's influence we keep doing wrong. What is that? He asks Krishna. And Krishna says this, kama esha krodha esha rajoguna samudbhavaha mahashana mahapapma. These two are there, kama and krodha. Kama is the desire for things. Where does this desire come from? Avidya. Ignorance that we are the body and the senses and we have to appease them, please them, enjoy. This kind of idea creates kama. And it is mahashana, it is insatiable. One desire you fulfill, another arises. Another you fulfill, third arises. So the moment you let the horse do what it wants, you can never control it back again. You have to keep the horse under control at all times. Because the horse is a little restless, okay, let him have a little free time. That's it, the horse is not going to come back to you. So never allow this horse to go out of control is what he's saying. This is very, very dangerous. It creates a lot of trouble for you. Once you leave it a little loose, it's going to create trouble for you. That horse is not going to listen to you again. So that dangerous are these senses as horses. They are unruly, untamed, wild. That is their nature. And they make us commit all kinds of sins because they have their own thing to do. So how to make these horses listen? How to make these horses follow? You have to control them through your mind. Mind is the reins. If the horse misbehaves, pull the rein. And then horse will behave himself. If you want the horse to turn right, pull the rein in a certain direction. If you want it to turn left, in a certain direction. If you want it to jump, you pull in a certain direction. So like this, there is a technique to control these horses. Like that, there is a technique to control these senses. Left to themselves, they'll only bring ruin. They'll go wild. To keep the senses under control is the skill of the rider. So this charioteer buddhi should know how to use the mind to control the horses and take them on the right road. You leave them free, they will take you wherever you want. And imagine if you had one horse, still okay, five horses you have to control together. That is why Adi Shankara says in his Viveka Chudamani, he says, Shabdadibhi panchabhireva panchaha, panchatma bapuhu swagudena baddha. Five of them are there, like Shabda Adi, means Shabda Sparsha Ruparasa Gandha. Five of them are there. And all these are there, which bind the people because of Swaguna. Swaguna means the nature. Sound, it wants to hear. Nose, it wants to smell. Skin, it wants to touch. Tongue, it wants to taste or talk. Like that, everything has its own thing to do. Eyes want to see. Swaguna is there. And these things bind by their nature itself. The eye's nature is that, tongue's nature is that. By its nature, it binds people. And what he gives example, Kuranga matanga patanga meena bhrunga nara panchabhiranchita kim. Kuranga, a deer. The deer is hunted by a hunter. What he does, he makes a little rustling noise with the dry leaves in the forest. This deer cannot but go towards the sound. It is so very helpless in front of its one sense of sound. It goes in that direction. And when it goes there, there is a net he is ready with. The moment deer comes, he puts that net on the deer, captures it. That's it, lifelong, now the deer is gone. He'll cut it, the deer, eat the flesh, take the skin, make chappals out of it, do whatever. Deer is gone. Because of being unable to control one horse of sound, shabda. Then sparsha, touch, elephant. Matanga. What does this elephant do? How they catch elephants? Very difficult to catch a big elephant just like that. They send a female, trained female elephant into the forest. And this female elephant goes and rubs itself against the male elephant. That male elephant goes mad with that touch. Forgets everything. As if swooned, as if swayed, as if hypnotized by that touch. It starts following the female elephant wherever she is going. And this female elephant is being trained. It has been promised a big pile of grass once she returns with a male elephant. So it goes back, the female elephant to the hunter, and the male elephant comes behind and they put a big net and catch hold of that male elephant. Now because of that one weakness of touch, whole life this male elephant had to slog, carry things for them, do all kinds of tamasha. It's always under the control of the mahout now. Look at this, independent, freely, happily roaming around in the forest. So that is the problem with these senses. They just attract you into them. So they suck you in. That is why baladiva niyojitaha, Arjuna says, as if forced, as if influenced, as if hypnotized. I mean, helpless in front of them. What is this? He's asking. He says, that is how senses are. They're made like this. So what you can do? You can't do anything in front of them. Mind, buddhi has to come into picture and control you, your senses. So matanga, elephant. Then patanga. Patanga is this moth, which sees the light, fire, and runs towards it. Especially after a rain, you will see a lot of these insects will be there. If you switch on the light, that's it. They will all come and sit on it. Knowing very well that they are going to go and get killed, yet they go. As if baladiva niyojita, as if forced to go and kill themselves. Very funny to look at, but that is how that is. And patanga, then meena, fish. A fish hook is there, in that they will put a small worm. And this fish goes and thinks, somehow I'll outsmart the fisherman and I'll pull the worm out and not get stuck. Till date, no fish has been able to do this. All fishes who went to malls got caught into some trouble or the other. Nobody said, I'm going into the mall, I'll just do window shopping and I will not touch anything and I'll come back unscathed. Never happened. Anybody who went definitely got caught. If not physically, mental desire has started. Now that desire will drive them. Till you go and get what you want, you will not be at peace. You will not sleep peacefully. So fish gets caught because of that fish hook and the little worm. And it's caught forever. Now fish is dead because they will eat it up. By evening it's gone. But because of its taste, the desire to taste its tongue is gone. And then last is bringa, the bee. This bee goes into flowers to smell and to taste the nectar. Now this sticky nectar of the flowers make it swoon. It goes and falls in it and the flower closes and the bee becomes the food for the flower. Instead of eating the flower, it gets eaten. By just because of one sense, that is to taste. This is the problem, Shankaracharya says, that because of one sense, Kuranga, Matanga, Patanga, Meena, Bringa, Naraha, Panchabiranchita Kim, man is influenced by all the five. What is the plight of a man? Tell me, if eyes he closes, ears will get him into ruin. If ears he closes, nose will get him into ruin. Nose he closes, touch will get him into ruin. Touch he closes, taste will get him into ruin. Something other will pull him in all directions. This is our biggest problem of the indriyas. Indriyahi vishaya grahanat kritva. This has been created to enjoy the vishayas, the sense pleasures. Indriyas have been created like that. Paranchi khani vyatruna swayambhu. That all the senses have been created by God in a way that it turns outwards only. It never goes inside. It always wants to taste things outwards. So only a kaschid dhira pratyag atmainishrat, the one who wants to realize Brahman, Atman, alone turns it inwards. That will come in the next chapter. But the idea of indriyas is that they have been created like this. So if you go and tell, why did Brahman create these indriyas outside? Should I have created inside only? There would not have been any problem at all. We all would have turned inside and enjoyed Brahman. Why create trouble and then solve the problem? But the truth is that this is the game of life. So Brahman thought, let me create like this. I'll create buddhi and I will create indriyas and mana. And I'll pitch them against each other. And let me see how the game goes on. Let me enjoy the chess game. Who wins? Indriyas win or buddhi wins? Let me see. And how indriyas and buddhi are connected? Through the mind. If indriyas pull the mind towards itself, the tug of war, have you seen tug of war we play, children play? If indriyas pull the mind towards itself, the rope towards itself, they win. If buddhi is powerful enough to pull the mind towards itself, buddhi wins. Depends on who. The tug of war is going on inside us all the time. All the time indriyas are telling, let us do this, let us hear this, let us go there, taste this, touch that, meet them. And buddhi says, no, that is not good. This is preyo marga, that is not a shreyo marga. This is not what will give us ultimate happiness. This is not what will make us eternally peaceful. Let us not do. But mind is confused. Should I listen to these indriyas or should I listen to the buddhi? And invariably it ends up listening to the indriyas. Because instant pleasure, instant noodles, instant accounts, everything instant. In today's world, nobody has any patience. So what if they have to pay a huge price later? They don't even think that far. Nobody thinks. They simply follow. Whatever has been told, they'll follow. Because instantly they are becoming happy. They get to eat, they get to touch, they get to taste, smell, hear. They're happy. Beyond that, it is not there. So that is the idea why these marketing companies, especially online shopping and all, are thriving. Because online shopping companies are giving you instant gratification. You want something, just order. You don't have money, don't worry, we'll give credit. You can't pay this, we will remortgage the whole thing to somebody else. They also can't pay, we'll third remortgage. If nothing works out, commit suicide, because that is the last option you have. Because otherwise bankers will come behind you. That's why people commit suicide after taking loans. They borrowed more than their capacity. Because they wanted instant pleasure. Now this man's life is caught. He is bonded labor. To whom? To his own ideas. Of cars, bungalows and pleasures and vacations. Everything is EMI. You go, anything is EMI. Go to the world, ask for anything. You can pay in easy installments. They're never easy. They were uneasy installments actually. But they make us think they're easy installments. But the uneasiness starts afterwards. When you really need that money for something very important. Somebody fell sick in the family. Somebody is really needing some financial support. But how can you save? You think banks will leave you? They'll say first pay the EMI. After that, if anything is left, then you can eat. And we all have fallen into this trap. Like the bee, Kuranga, Matanga, Patanga, Meena, Bringa, we have fallen. As if forced into it. Why? Because we compare with others. My friends have got a new car. I have still old car. And I don't know. How did they get the car? They took a loan. So let me also go and take a loan. That is how we get ourselves killed. This is the idea of the five senses and sense gratification, which is the danger. So who can control this? Buddhi can control this. What kind of buddhi? There are three kinds of buddhis that everybody is endowed with. Sattvika buddhi, Rajasika buddhi and Tamasika buddhi. Now what is the quality of each buddhi? Sattvika buddhi, it can discriminate correctly. Pravruttam cha nivruttam cha dharma adharme karya akarye bhaya, abhaye, all these discriminations are possible. What is pravritti means what is instinct based, what is nivritti, what is the redemption or the ultimate goodness based decision making. Then karya, akarya. Karya means which should be done as per the rules, conducts, moral policies, everything, and akarya, that which should not be done. Bhaya, abhaye. Bhaya means that which will lead to fear, mistakes lead to fear. Abhaya means which will make us fearless. We are not bound. We are not afraid of EMIs. We are not afraid of bankers anymore. Because we never fell into that trap. So bhaya abhaya. And ultimate discrimination also it teaches. Moksham cha bandham cha. See, which will take you to bondage in this body. And what will give you ultimate freedom. It teaches you that. That buddhi knows. That is why it's called buddhi sa partha sattviki. Sattviki buddhi is this buddhi which tells you exactly what is right, wrong, doable, not doable, what will lead to fear, what will lead to fearlessness, and ultimately what will lead you to your freedom and what will lead you to your bondage. And this freedom bondage is not somewhere after death. Here only we experience. When you desire for something and then go and buy it on a EMI, bondage. So idea is that this is not the way to lead life. Don't spend before you earn. And this generation has to learn this lesson. Because this is the generation which is the most vulnerable to this. The previous generations have made their mistakes. You don't make this mistake. Be happy with limited. What you need, use that. Don't go behind wants. But all the advertising and marketing is all about teaching you wants. They will make the want appear as a need. You should have better discrimination. So idea is that. So first buddhi is that which can discriminate between four things. Pravrittam, nivrittam, karya, akarye, bhaya, abhaye, bandha and moksham. Remember these things. Don't forget it after some time. The second kind of buddhi is rajasi buddhi. What does rajasi buddhi think? It misunderstands. It doesn't understand it correctly. So the shloka that our Krishna Bhagavan tells in Bhagavad Gita for that. The buddhi sings yaya dharma adharmam cha karya akarya meva cha. What is dharma, what is adharma, what is karya, means what should be done, what should not be done. Ayathavat prajanati. It understands in a different way than what it has been told. Ayathavat prajanati. Buddhi sa partha rajasi. That rajasi buddhi misunderstands it, correctly does not understand. And then we have the tamasi buddhi, means something is told to you. Take right, you are taking left. Or take right and you are confused. Which is right? This kind of buddhi which cannot take decisions or takes wrong decisions because of its own understanding, misunderstanding. So idea is that buddhi, sattva buddhi will discriminate. Rajas buddhi is under moha, delusion. What will be a tamas buddhi? Tamas buddhi is the third one, the worst of the buddhis, it says. What does it do? Adharmam dharmam iti. What is adharma? It thinks it is dharma. Why it thinks so? Ya manyate tamasavrita, because of the darkness of in the mind, because there is no sense of thinking in the mind, that darkness, it thinks adharma is the dharma. And what does it do? Sarvartham vipritanscha. Buddhiyas parthas tamasi. That buddhi which thinks everything in the opposite way. Take right, they will take left. Exactly, they will do the opposite. That's why you tell students, don't go near, they will precisely go there. Don't go there means they'll go there. Don't meet this person, they'll go and meet this person. Don't see what is inside the box. That's it. Till they open the box, they will not be quiet. All ulta things they will do. So that is the tamasi buddhi. Look at Duryodhana's buddhi. Tamasi buddhi. Arjuna and Duryodhana both came to ask Krishna for help. And Arjuna came and sat at the feet. Duryodhana sat right at the head. And Krishna, who was playing a drama, he opened an eyes and saw who is sitting where. And then he decided, I'll open my eyes and see Arjuna first, just to make the Duryodhana feel a little more terrible. And he opened his eyes and said, oh Arjuna, when did you come? I am also here, Duryodhana. Oh Duryodhana, when did you come? I came before Arjuna. Oh, is it so? But I saw Arjuna first. So let me tell Arjuna what he wants. And Duryodhana is now upset. Arjuna, if he asks for all the army, I will be at a loss. And Arjuna asks, I want you. Between the two, I want you. Duryodhana is so happy. He's thinking Arjuna is a fool. He doesn't know what is right, what is wrong. Actually, Duryodhana does not know. But he thinks Arjuna does not know. And he thinks, okay, now that Arjuna has made his first choice of taking you, I will settle with your army, that's all right. But in heart of hearts, he's jumping in joy. I got whole army, this fool Arjuna has taken Krishna, that too, who cannot even fight a war. He has to be a charioteer. But look at the kind of charioteer Arjuna chose, the Buddhi as the charioteer. And that led him to success, victory. Whereas Duryodhana took all the army and left the Buddhi behind. Took the Indriya, took the Manas, left the Buddhi behind. And where did he end up? In his ruin. That is the idea. The charioteer is to be Buddhi. Like Krishna was the charioteer for Arjuna. Arjuna chose Buddhi over Indriyas and Manas. Duryodhana chose Indriyas and Manas over Buddhi. He got lot of horses, but he did not know how to control them. Here is Arjuna who said, I will get the good right charioteer, and he will know whichever horse I give him, he will know how to control them. So that is how he became. So this is the significance behind the chariot story and our lives. So that is how Arjuna could get victory, whereas Duryodhana suffered. So if you give all the horses, all the indriyas and your mind in the hands of Buddhi, and whose Buddhi? Sattva Buddhi. Sattva Buddhi is divine thinking, divine discrimination, not human discrimination, not sense-based discrimination. Give it in the hands of God. That's why beautifully in 12th chapter also, Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Mayeva mana adhastva, mai buddhim niveshaya, nivasishyasi mayeva, ata urdhvam na sanshayaha, he says. Give your mind to me, Krishna is saying. Give the reins to me. Give your buddhi also to, means what? Merge your buddhi in my buddhi. Let me become your charioteer. Give me the chance. And then what? Mayeva mana adhastva, mai buddhim niveshaya, nivasishyasi mayeva. Having offered everything to me, surrendered to me, ata urdhvam na samshayaha, you will definitely evolve. There is no doubt about it. Because all other buddhis will take you down. You devolve. Whereas when you give this buddhi in the hands of God, or think like how God will think. That's why I always tell you, behave like you are God. Because that is what you are. Speak as if you are God. Think as if you are God. Act as if you are God. That buddhi you use is something you do which is not in accordance with your godliness, immediately tell yourself, why am I behaving like this? Is it what, does this suit my divine nature? Is it in accordance to my divine nature? If it is not, then let me not do it. Simple as that. Vairagya. Viveka Vairagya. So this buddhi should be endowed with this. That is why buddhi is a charioteer. In today's time, there are cars. So you have a car that is like the body. And then you have a driver, which is the buddhi. And there is a steering wheel that is like the Manas. So in a car, that is the body, there is a steering wheel, which is the mind, and the driver is the buddhi. The tires are the senses, just to show the connection between turning the steering wheel and turning of the tire, and you are just the passenger, jiva in the car. Now everything is perfect, your driver is good, your car is in good shape, driver knows how to drive, then you can simply enjoy the ride. You can watch the scenery outside. You can watch the nice trees and mountains and everything else. But if you don't have a good driver, all the time your heart will be in your mouth. When this fellow will go and make an accident, we don't know. Suppose he's a sattvic driver, what will he say? He'll greet you in the morning. Good morning, sir. Where are we going today? Then he will tell, we are going this place, that place. Suppose he does not know the proper direction. Every now and then he will ask, sir, do I have to take right here or do I have to take left? Then you will tell, no, next right, next left. And he will simply follow your instructions and carefully, without accelerating, without breaking signals, without causing damage to anybody or itself, carefully will take the car to the destination. This is sattva buddhi. Now, rajasic buddhi, what will it do? It won't greet you in the morning. It will decide where to go that day. It won't listen to you. We will go to Bangalore today. That, can it happen like that? It doesn't listen to you at all. What kind of driver is this? So that buddhi is rajasi buddhi. It just does its own thing. Whatever it wants, it does without thinking. If you tell you have to turn right, it will think you are turning left. If you tell him go straight, he will take a U-turn. All these kinds of these things happen with the rajasi buddhi. Like a drunk driver. Can't understand the instructions correctly. He's drunk. Suddenly the car is swinging this way, then that way, then changing lanes, then suddenly applying brake, braking signals. All kinds. Behind, look at the passenger's plight in a drunkard driver's car. And the tamasic buddhi is worse. Why? He's a drunk driver and also blind. And also deaf. Now think of your car ride. Doesn't listen to you, he can't listen, deaf. Can't see anything right, wrong. And on top of that, he's drunk also. That is tamas buddhi. What will this buddhi do? It will go and only make accidents in life. So now you tell me, whenever accidents happen, your buddhi has slipped into the lower category of tamas buddhi. It got drunk with desires. I want to have it. I know it's bad, but I want to do it. I know it's bad, but I want to hear it. Bad. I want to see it. Drunk by the ignorance, drunk by the desires. And deaf. Deaf to your conscience. Blind to right and wrong. And gets into all kinds of mess. You sit and think for yourself. It has happened like this only. Whenever your desire is overpowered, you couldn't hear and think. Rajasi buddhi, it's drunk. But still it can hear you. When you tell from behind the passenger seat, listen, listen, take a right, it may not always follow. But at least it knows that it is in charge of the car and it is driving the car. Some sense is there, it's not absolute nonsense there. So Rajasic Buddhi can be controlled and turned into Sattvic quickly. But Tamasic Buddhi, very difficult to pull it out of that Tamas and take it to Rajas, very difficult. Rajasic Buddhi still we can control, tame it and shout at the driver and maybe driver will behave. But Tamasic Buddhi, if you shout, whom are you shouting? He's deaf, can't hear. So there's no point in shouting. You have to throw the driver out of the car and get a good driver. That is the only solution to that. Can't even train that buddhi. But Sattvic buddhi is a good driver. Well kept, well maintains the car, well listens to whatever you say, never drinks, smokes, never troubles you. Always follows the instruction. He's aware of where we are going. He is aware of traffic rules, directions. Such a person alone can take you to your destination. So this is the charioteer concept in the chariot of body. If buddhi is the most important aspect because buddhi controls the mind. That's why it says, indriyaihi vishaya grahanam kritva. It's only to experience, collection of experience is indriya's jobs. It doesn't think and collect, it just collects. Whatever comes its way, it collects. It doesn't think. Then what manasa do? Manasa sankalpya. Indriyas have engaged in the experiences. Mind is the one which documents all the experiences. And then what happens? He passes it on to buddhi. Buddhya nischityaha. Buddhi decides what to do with these things. That is the idea. And body is only karma kritena. For the sake of conducting one's activities is the body, the chariot. So the experiences that indriyas collect is given to the mind. And mind passes on to buddhi. And buddhi decides a good thing, bad thing, wrong thing. Suppose you see something. Immediately your mind has collected the experience, it has gone to your buddhi and buddhi has told, no, it is a wrong thing, don't see. Immediately mind will tell the eyes, shut yourself or look other way. All this happens in a fraction of a second inside us. But there is an algorithm which runs up and down and controls our body. Like in a car, everything happens so fast, but there's a huge amount of electronics and engineering that has gone in to make the decisions happen so fast. Likewise, there is a process inside us. But when buddhi goes bad, troubles begin. That's where we all go wrong. Buddhi nashat pranashyati, it says. If your buddhi goes wrong, that's it, you are ruined. Nobody can help you after that. So what is the other idea? My buddhi is very chanchala. Our Arjuna says, chanchalam hi mana krishna pramadi balavadrunam. Very difficult. Vayu riva. As difficult as controlling air. So how do I control my mind? Mind means buddhi aspect of mind is talking about. Not the thinking aspect, the decision aspect of mind. Because manas has mana, buddhi, chitta and ahankara. So buddhi part of it makes the decision. The manas part of it only collects. Chitta parts of it stores. Ahankara identifies. So this in this aspect, manas is the thinking part of it. Buddhi is the decision making. So decision making is happening by buddhi part of the mind alone. And that is vijnanamaya kosha, like manomaya kosha, then we have vijnanamaya kosha. So from there the decisions would come, then anandamaya kosha is experiencing happiness. If the decisions are all go wrong, anandamaya kosha is all going wrong, pranamaya is simply following. And manomaya is not able to think properly because vijnanamaya is not giving right directions. Where is ananda in that person's life? There is no ananda in that person's life because everything is out of sync. So that is why Krishna says all the time, tasmat sarveshu kaleshu mam anusmara yudhyacha mayyarpita mano buddhi mamai vaishyasi asamshaya. All the time therefore think of me and me is what Krishna says, Tasma Sarveshu Kaleshu, all the time, morning, evening, Kuru Punya Mahoratram Smaranityam Anityatam. Think of me all the time. Offer your mind and buddhi also to me. Tasma Sarveshu Kaleshu Mam Anusmara Yudhyacha Mayarpita Mano Buddhi Mamaiveshya Samshaya. You will reach me. Where are these horses going? Where is this chariot going? It's going to God. It's going to realization of self. So how do we realize self? Krishna says, Mayarpita Mano Buddhi Mamaiveshya Samshaya. Offer your buddhi and mind to me. Let me be your charioteer. I will take you across. Don't worry, you enjoy the ride behind. Let me be your driver. Let your buddhi be guided by God. How? By if you think of God all the time, your buddhi will be guided by God. Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu mam anusmara. Keep remembering me. You go back and think, any mistake you ever made in your life, any word that you ever spoke unnecessarily, any thought you ever entertained inadvertently, which was not good, were those times when you forgot to think of God. Any time you thought of God, it was not possible for you to go and make a mistake. It is not possible. All the mistakes of our lives are when we don't think of God. When our buddhi and mind are not surrendered to God. That is the only time we make mistakes. Otherwise, we never make any mistake in life. You simply think for yourself, in the last 15, 16 days, a fortnight, the number of mistakes that you have made versus the number of mistakes you have made in so many fortnights of your life before. You know the difference, isn't it? Are you still making the same number of mistakes? Even if you are making mistakes now, you are very conscious, I am making a mistake. Earlier, unconsciously, unmindfully, mistakes were being made. On top of that, you are arrogant that I never made a mistake. Now, first you are avoiding mistakes, and if you are making a mistake, you have the consciousness, mindfulness that this is a mistake. I overspoke today. I unnecessarily thought of things today. I unnecessarily quarreled. This consciousness is slowly awakening in you. It means what? Your buddhi is slowly turning from rajasic to sattvic. The purification of buddhi is happening. And that is the secret of a happy life. When buddhi is completely under the control of your Atman, divinity, whatever Atman says, buddhi does accordingly. The driver simply does not decide, listens to the passenger. Passenger should tell, today we are going to railway station, let's go that side. He will take to railway station only, not to the bus stand. Likewise, buddhi should be completely under the control of Atman. Manas should be under the control of buddhi. Indriyas should be under the control of manas. That is when life is a happy journey. Otherwise, all life we are going to struggle. One horse or the other will pull us in the wrong direction. Our chariot will be swinging this way, that way, not reach anywhere. In fact, meet with accidents and you will suffer inside the chariot. All the suffering is because of this disconnect between the Atman, Buddhi, Mana and Indriyas. So develop this idea and use this idea of this chariot to the best of your advantage. I was telling the other day, I can't control 5 horses at a time. Which horse should I control? I tell you, first control your tongue. That horse is the worst horse. Because this tongue, though it's a very soft thing, but it's extremely harsh, sharper than a sword. Being the softest flesh is harder than the iron. That is the problem with the tongue. Control the tongue. And if you control one tongue, you control 2 things. It's a 2-in-1. Rasana and Jivha. Rasana is when it tastes and Jivha when it talks. So if you control one tongue, you can control 2 of your horses. Which are the 2 horses? One is of eating, other horse is of talking. It's so good that if you can control one tongue. Therefore, before open your mouth to eat or to talk, think. Is it good for me to eat this? Is it bad for me? So control one organ to begin with. Start with your tongue, speak less, eat appropriately. That's where spiritual progress will begin, one step at a time. Shanai, shanai, uparamet. Slowly, slowly, you are gain control over all the horses. Otherwise, very, very, very difficult. And this is the idea of chariot and horses and the charioteer. Meditate on this idea. Till this idea is fully understood by you, and you say, if I cannot, my buddhi is not capable of controlling my life, I surrender that buddhi to God. Means what? Not my will, thy will be done. That is surrender of buddhi to God. And God takes over. How he takes over, which way he does things, all these things we will see in the coming shlokas. That how you surrender each to the other. Indriya should be surrendered to mind, mind should be surrendered to buddhi, buddhi should be surrendered to Atman. Atman also should be surrendered to Paramatman. That is how one should lead one's life, not the other way around. That we will learn in the coming shlokas. For today, this is enough. But do pay attention to all these. They are one of the most profoundest of the truths told in the most practical way. There could not have been a better way of teaching spirituality and spiritual truths than going step by step logically like Kathopanishad. Begins with a observation and inquiry and discarding of the wrong and choosing the right over the wrong. Then learns further, saying that you have to be very determined, you have to be very, very focused and keen, and ultimately you should only choose this above everything else. This can't be one of the many, this should be the one and the only. Such a person who has developed this kind of focus and determination becomes eligible to know this. From there, now slowly the description is starting. How do you start walking on this path? So it is not that Yama said, just because you want it, it will come and reveal to you. But before it reveals to you, it will check. What it will check? Whether you are Navarito Duscharita, Ashanto, Asamahita, Ashanta Manaso, it will check all these things. So now how to make my mind peaceful? How to make my disposition calm? How to ensure that I desist from doing wrong? This is the example. That you think of yourself as a chariot, senses as the horses, mind as the reins, buddhi as the charioteer, and yourself as the Atman, which is the passenger riding this chariot. And now start controlling your senses, mind, and there is a nice meditation which will come next. And that's how you can develop the Shanta Manasa, pure and calm mind. You can desist from doing the wrong things. You will not even have the eagerness or impatience to get liberated or realized. And because of all these basic qualities fulfilled, and also because you have Mumukshatvam, Brahman will reveal himself at the right time to you. So that is the logic of proceeding or progressing in Kathopanishad right now.